Hello students, welcome to the class on economic survey. This class is for chapter number 4, volume 1. Now this chapter deals with the issues related to agriculture. Now this is one such chapter that holds a lot of potential to give you a jump of around 5 to 10 marks in the mains examination. Because in this year's economic survey, in this very chapter, the government has put forward the policy and the program that should be guiding the agriculture from where it has got stagnated. So this is a chapter which has summarized the entire thing that needs to be done to this sector of agriculture. Now, before we understand this chapter, we also need to know something about Green Revolution. Now, Green Revolution, it was a big paradigmatic, it was a transcendental change in the Indian agriculture. Now, before Green Revolution, the productivity of the Indian agriculture was quite less, and the Green Revolution has given a stupendous jump. It has given a phenomenal jump. It has given a huge jump to the productivity of the Indian agriculture. Now, when it comes to agriculture, agriculture is a very broad term. Agriculture in itself includes horticulture, agriculture includes cereal production, agriculture includes pulses production, agriculture includes oil seeds production, agriculture includes dairy farming, agriculture includes fishery, agriculture includes sericulture, etc. So agriculture in itself is a very broad idea, it's a very broad concept. But from this chapter's point of view, we'll be discussing only from the perspective of oil seeds, from cereals, from pulses, and from certain other crops. And what we will be excluding in this chapter is the discussion about the animal husbandry, the fishery, and the dairy. We will not be discussing about these things. So the main focus will relate to a piece of land and utilizing that piece of land for sowing the crops and non-crops. Now, Green Revolution, it has given a lot of positives to the Indian agriculture. But apart from the positives that we had from this Green Revolution, there were certain negatives that are attached, that are associated with the Green Revolution. And one big negative about the Green Revolution is that it had a very narrow focus. Now, what is meant by narrow focus? Now, the narrow focus means by utilizing this Green Revolution technology, by focusing on the inputs of fertilizer, seed, water, we have focused only on enhancing the cereal production. Now, we have utilized these things. We have utilized fertilizer, water, seeds to increase the productivity of the cereals. But what we have not increased? We have not increased the productivity of the oil seeds. We have not increased the productivity of the pulses. So the focus of the Green Revolution, it was a very myopic one. And this myopic vision of Green Revolution has caused a debilitating pain to the Indian farmer. Now the Indian farmers' incomes, they have got stagnated. Now with the entire focus about the agriculture was on the cereals. Now, producing these cereals, you have to provide these cereals with a lot of inputs. Inputs in terms of irrigation, inputs in terms of seeds, inputs in terms of fertilizers. And the most important element in agriculture is that of irrigation. Now, irrigation means water. 80 to 85% of the entire water usage that is done in India, it is done by the agriculture sector. So there is a lot of mismanagement of water in Indian agriculture. Now, why I am saying there is mismanagement of water in Indian agriculture? I am saying this because the way we are practicing this irrigation, it is actually not the right way to do. We are practicing basically flood irrigation. Now, what is meant by flood irrigation? Now, flood irrigation means you focus on to spread the water on to the piece of land. Now, when water is spread on the soil, when water is spread on the land, from here, from the land, the water is sucked by the plants. The water is taken in by the plants. But when you spread this water on a piece of land, it leads to a lot of wastage. Now, why wastage? How the wastage takes place? The wastage takes place by excessive evaporation. Now, due to evaporation, we tend to lose a lot of water. So there is a lot of mismanagement of water that is currently going in this agriculture sector. And India is a water deficient country. Just remember this thing. This is very, very important. Now, when it comes to irrigation, this year's economic survey has come out with a novel idea. Now, this idea was earlier prevalent, but this idea is being hit on by the finance ministry. This idea is hit on by the cabinet minister, cabinet minister's council. Now, they want to introduce a transition. They want to introduce a change in the way we are irrigating our fields. Now, the focus should be on micro irrigation. Now, what is meant by micro irrigation? Micro irrigation means you are using a drop of water directly to feed the roots. You're using a drop of water directly to feed the stems of the plants. Now, what is the agenda behind this micro irrigation? The agenda behind the drip irrigation and the sprinkler irrigation is that there should be more crop per drop. Now, in the flood irrigation, what we were focusing on? We were just focusing on enhancing the productivity, but we were not caring for the input. Input means water usage. When it comes to the water usage in China or in Brazil or for the matter in Myanmar or in United States of America, the usage of the water is about 50% of what India is using. So we need to be about 50% more efficient in the usage of water, because this is a scarce resource. There's a term used in the economic survey, and the term is economization of the resources. This is a very important term. You must use this in your mains answers. Economization of the resources. Now, what is meant by economization of the resources? Economization of the resources means that we should be using lesser resources. We should be more productive. We should be more efficient in enhancing the yields in the Indian agriculture, and how can that be done? How can we economize the usage of irrigation? How can we economize the usage of seeds? How can we economize the usage of fertilizers? We can do that if we will transit, if we will shift our focus from the grains, from the cereal crops, to the pulses and to the oil seeds. Because pulses is a big requirement for a country like India. The per capita consumption of protein through the pulses, it has been declining at a very phenomenal pace. And we need to restrict that. How can that be restricted? That can be restricted if we will shift the focus to the pulses and to the oil seeds. Now, in comparison to the water guzzling crops like rice, cotton, these pulses and oil seeds, they relatively require lesser amount of water. Now, when these things require, when these crops require lesser amount of water, by doing this, we will actually be economizing the resource use in the Indian agriculture. Now, if we will be using less water by sprinkler irrigation, we will also be using less power, and the entire power thing is subsidized in the Indian agriculture. The power is almost free. So this will also have a spin-off positive effect in the power sector. When we will be using the sprinkler and drip irrigation, it will also require a lesser use of the fertilizer. When it will require a lesser use of the fertilizer, the subsidy of the about 72,000 crore rupees that we are providing to the fertilizer sector, that will come down. So, the challenge in the Indian agriculture is the challenge to enhance the productivity. Now, when it comes to wheat production, the yield, the average yield that we are having per hectare, it is just 2500 kgs per hectare. Now compare this 2500 kg per hectare with around 6000 kg per hectare in United States of America, or 5500 kg per hectare in China. So this jump, this gap is, this hiatus, this chasm is actually a big one, and we really need to bridge this chasm. We really need to bridge this gap. And how can that be done? More crop per drop, and shifting our priorities in the agriculture. Because what we see is that India has become a country which is actually exporting water. So this is about a general thing in the Indian agriculture. This year's economic survey has come out with certain very fine analysis about the Indian culture, agriculture. What are those things? Foremost thing that it has talked about is about the water export. What is meant by water export, I will be discussing with you. And the second thing that this year's economic survey has highlighted is about the relationship between irrigation and pulses. And the third thing that this year's economic survey has highlighted through this chapter is the issue of price dispersion. And the fourth thing that this year's economic survey has highlighted is the price wedge. Now, what is meant by water export? When you look at the type of the crops that are exported from India, now which crop generally India exports? We export cotton, we export rice. we export maize. Now these crops, rice and maize and cotton, they are actually water guzzling crops. They intake a lot of water. Now when they intake a lot of water and we are exporting such crops, it means we are exporting Indian water to the foreign nations. Now India is a water scarce nation. We are just having 4% of water resources and we are having around 17 to 18% of the water population. So the per capita availability of water to an Indian is less in comparison to what an American or a Chinese is having. So in such a case, we should not be exporting such crops. Rather, we should be importing such crops. And this policy is followed by China. Because when we're talking about agriculture, we also need to focus on the issues, the areas which are attached to agriculture. And the water thing is very important to agriculture. So this is the concept of water export, and this can be asked in your mains examination. Now the second thing that economic survey has highlighted is the relationship between irrigation and pulses. Now pulses in India, they are having a lesser yield in comparison to what the yield is in the countries of Brazil, is in the countries like Bangladesh and Myanmar. Now these countries are having about 50% more yield than what Indian pulses are having. Now what is the reason behind that? Now the economic survey has surveyed that wherever the pulses are sown in India, they are sown in rain fed area. Now how much is the total rain fed area in India? 65% is the rain fed area in India. It makes to be around 200 million hectare. Now what is meant by rain fed area? Rain fed area means that the agriculture is not dependent on irrigation, man-made irrigation. It is dependent only on natural irrigation. Natural irrigation means by way of rainfall. Barish hogi to wahan pe fasal ug jayegi, barish nahi hogi to wahan pe fasal nahi ugegi. 65% hamare paas total net sown jo area hai wo rain fed hai hamare paas. So and jo pulses hain, main source of protein, they are entirely sown in this rain fed area. So we need to work on the agroclimatic regions. We need to work on the agroclimatic zones. We need to bridge the gap between the lab and the land. What is meant by this bridging the gap between the lab and the land? Now it means that the research facilities should actually move close to the land. The researchers, they should be directly guiding the farmers. Somebody who is BSc or MSc in agriculture should be guiding the illiterate farmers about the usage of pesticides, the weedicides, the fertilizers, and how to economize the resource usage. And then the third thing that the economic survey has potently highlighted is the issue of price dispersion. Now what is meant by price dispersion? Price dispersion means that there is a difference between the selling price, the minimum selling price and the maximum selling price. Now when it comes to Indian agriculture, because Indian farmer is actually a poor farmer, most of the land holdings are very small, and the kind of the support system that the farmers are having, it is actually pitiable. It's not that good, and they require a lot of support from the government because it is also dependent on the adversities of the nature. Now, the adversarial nature of the monsoon also makes it very contingent and dependent to provide the support to the Indian farmer. Now, the support is provided in terms of minimum support price. Now, the government assures the farmers that they will be provided with this minimum price level even if there is an excess of production of a particular crop. Now, this MSP is there for 23 crops, but in terms of implementation, there are 3 crops which have utilized this provision of minimum support price, and these crops are white, wheat, rice and sugarcane, and rest of the crops like groundnut, like maize, like pulses, like oil seeds, though they are under minimum support price regime, but the farmers are not aware about this. So there is a lack of awareness in the Indian agriculture about the MSP, minimum support price. Minimum support price, wo price jiske upar aap sarkar ko sell kar sakte ho agar aapko market mein utna price nahi mil raha hai. Ye basic support price hai ki farmer ko kahin pe jane ki zarurat hai, but iska utilization jo hai MSP ka pulses mein bilkul nahi hai, oil seeds mein bilkul nahi hai, ground nuts mein bilkul nahi hai, kyunki farmer ko is cheez ki awareness hi nahi hai Indian agriculture mein ki in crops mein bhi MSP exist karta hai ya nahi karta hai. To iski wajah se jin logon ko to ye pata hi nahi hai ki MSP exist karta hai, to MSP ka jo threshold level hai, suppose this is the threshold level, इस प्राइस से नीचे बहुत सारे फार्मर्स अपने अपने क्रॉप्स को सेल कर देते हैं, और जिनको अवेयरनेस है और जहां जिस क्रॉप का प्रोडक्टिविटी कम होता है तो वो फार्मर थ्रेशोल्ड प्राइस से ऊपर करते हैं. तो व्हाट इज मेंट बाय प्राइस डिस्पर्शन? प्राइस डिस्पर्शन मींस आपका 1 kg व्हीट 10 रुपीस केजी मिनिमम में भी जा रहा है और 100 रुपीस केजी में भी जा रहा है. दिस द मैक्सिमम प्राइस. तो डिफरेंस कितना हो गया? एक 10 में जा रहा है और एक 100 में 90 रुपीस का डिफरेंस हो गया. सो इन एग्रीकल्चर वी आर नॉट हैविंग अ यूनिफाइड मार्केट. वी हैव एपीएमसी एक्ट, एग्रीकल्चर प्रोड्यूस मार्केटिंग एक्ट. नाउ दिस एग्रीकल्चर इज अ स्टेट सब्जेक्ट. बीइंग अ स्टेट सब्जेक्ट, दिस एक्ट says that a farmer should be selling its crop, the yield of its crop, the production of its crop only in the stipulated yards, only in the stipulated mandis. And in order to sell the crop in the mandis, they have to take a license of that mandi, and that is sold in the mandis through the middlesman. So this is one of the biggest lacunas in the marketing of the agriculture produce in the Indian agriculture. So what is the reason of the price dispersion? There is no all India national market where you can come out with, like for the gold, there is a single price, be that Chennai, be that Chandigarh, be that Ahmedabad, be that Hyderabad, there will be a very less difference in the gold price. There might be difference, slight difference because of the taxes, but more or less it remains the same. But this is not true for the agricultural commodities, because we are not having the nationalized market with respect to agriculture. The market is constrained in the Indian agriculture, And this is one of the reasons why the Indian farmer is so poor. Why the Indian farmer has not been able to actualize the potential in terms of revenue. That is about the price wedge. So what is meant by price wedge? Now, price wedge means that there is a difference between the price that is paid to a farmer in the wholesale market and in the retail market. Now, in the wholesale people, what they do, they buy from a farmer in the mandis and in the yards, they will buy it at a very lesser rate. And when it comes to the retail market, they will sell it at an exorbitant price. So, the commodity remains the same, the crop remains the same, but what is pocketed by the farmer, it actually is very less. And in such a scenario, the farmer who is earning less, he fails in modernizing the agriculture. Now, how can we modernize the agriculture? This is another issue over which the economic survey has really focused on. One was the market issue, and last issue is the research and the development issue, or the technology issue, implementation of technology in agriculture. Now, when it comes to the agriculture education in India, it is in a pitiable condition. I've already told you about the gap between the lab and the land. We're doing very less research in Indian agriculture. We are totally dependent on the high yielding variety seeds. And these seeds, they come at a very exorbitant rate. And there's a term called as, very important term, seed replacement rate. Now, what is meant by seed replacement rate? Agar aaj maine 1 acre of land mein high yielding varieties rice seeds laga ke cultivation kiya hai, to next baar wo mujhe dobara fir se khareedna padega. Because this is the quality of the HYV ki dobara se main jo unse seeds aayenge crop se wo dobara se ek nayi fasal ko unse nahi ho sakti. They have been made impotent. The potency of the seeds has been made so less that you cannot reuse the seeds. Reuse the new seeds. So in that case, you are required to buy again from the market. So in such a situation, what a poor farmer in India do? In such a situation, the Indian farmer actually uses the traditional crops rather than high yielding variety. Now, what does this lead to? It leads to lower production, lower yields, lower incomes of the Indian farmer. Now, the average annual income of the Indian farmer is just 20,000 rupees. This is what is in the economic survey. And this kind of earnings is very less. So most of the Indian farmers, they are close to BPL, below poverty line. So we need to enhance research and development in the agriculture sector. Now, why we need to work on research and development in Indian agriculture? Because of the teeming millions, because of the burgeoning population, because we are getting close to 130 crore population will be there. So that population will put a lot of pressure on the resources, and we really need to extract maximum from these resources by economizing the usage of the resources. So this year's economic survey has talked about the potentials in the pulses, in the oil seeds, and how we need to bring about changes. It has highlighted certain important issues like price dispersion, the price wedge issue, and the issues about the irrigation in the pulses and about the water and about the lacunas of the green revolution. So this was all for this class. And you can also download the Brainiki maps with respect to economic survey from brainiki.com. And in case you have any sort of query about this economic survey, you can contact me on WhatsApp. And the number is 84594000. And you can also buy this classes on entire civil services preparation on brainiki.com. And you can contact me for that. And you can also have the information about the classes that we're offering from brainiki.com and from eiasmentors.com. And in case you're interested in joining the offline class that we take, they are in Delhi and in Chandigarh. And we provide classes on general studies and on public administration. So bye bye, take care, have a nice day.